So maybe you already used a stepper motor, a DC motor, or a BLDC motor in one of your projects. And now you're thinking that you are the master of motors. Well, let me introduce you to this monstrosity. Which is actually just a monstrosity if you compare it to the size of the previously shown motors. This is a so-called asynchronous motor, or induction motor. And this one has been sitting in my shelf for eternities, and I do not even know whether it still works. So for this video, I thought it would be appropriate to show you how to get such a motor to work, and what advantages it offers in comparison to other hobbyist motors. Because, let's face it, the asynchronous motor type is nowadays still the most widely used motor type in the world. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by JLC PCB. Feel free to visit their website to not only find out what awesome PCB and assembly services they offer, but also to easily upload your Gerber files to order affordable and high quality PCBs easily. First off, in order to understand how this motor works, I opened up its terminal box and was promptly greeted by 6 connector wires. Through the help of my multimeter, I found out that the wires U1, U2, V1, V2, and W1 and W2 all form a separate coil. Usually, such a box also comes with such bridge connector pieces, which either ties a side of each coil to another one to form a delta configuration, or we use them to tie one side of all the coils to one point and thus create a star configuration. But more about those types later. For now, I removed all the important screws of the motor to take it apart and understand its construction better. I was able to remove the back piece without a problem, which revealed a fan that is directly connected to the rotor and basically cools the motor during operation. But while trying to open up the front part, I ran into a problem where the gear system didn't want to let go of the rotor. So, even though we can see a bit of the insides, I was not happy with this result. But I really didn't want to destroy the motor, because my mission was to see whether it still works. That means, after I reassembled this old asynchronous motor, I simply ordered myself a new one as a test subject. So, once again, I removed all the screws and thankfully was quickly capable of removing the rotor from the system. Now, the rotor is obviously the part of the motor that rotates, and in this case it is made up of a scribble cage. It basically consists of conductive metal sticks, which are shorted to one another at each end. And to understand the purpose of this rotor design choice, we should next have a proper look at the stator of the motor, which is obviously the part of the motor that stays in place. In our case, all that we can see, however, is that there are a lot of copper wires going in and out of it. And yes, those are the coils whose end wires we can find in the terminal box. So, just by looking, we cannot truly understand how this motor works. So, why not simply connect it to a voltage to get it going? But let me tell you that a DC voltage is in this case not sufficient. On the type plates of the new motor, it is not so easy to spot. But on the type plate of the old motor, we can see that both motors require a 3-phase AC voltage. And apparently with values of 230 volts, 400 volts. Which I luckily got laying around due to German house wiring standards. And that is the point where I have to tell you that working with 230 volts or 400 volts can be lethal, and should only be done by a professional. Which is probably why such asynchronous motors are not often seen in hobbyist projects. But luckily I'm a professional, and thus easily wired up a 400 volts CEE cable, whose L1, L2 and L3 phase feature a voltage of 400 volts to one another and 230 volts in relation to the neutral wire. But what does this 230 volts / 400 volts mean? Should I use 230 volts or 400 volts? And with what motor coil configuration? Well, the first number basically says what maximum voltage the coils can handle. And thus, if we would have 230 volts between phases, we could directly apply them to each coil through the delta configuration. But since we got 400 volts between the phases, we have to follow the second 400 volt rating, which says that you should use a star configuration at 400 volt levels, since that will reduce the voltages across each coil to 230 volts. Luckily, the star configuration was still in place, and thus I hooked up PE, L1, L2 and L3. But before powering anything, I reassembled the motor and only then supplied it with voltage to find out that it spins just fine. As an experiment, we can measure the current through one phase to see that it draws around 450 milliamps. But if you would have wired up the motor incorrectly in the delta configuration, then the current will multiply by almost 10, and the magic smoke will appear fairly quickly. But anyway, the rotor of our motor rotates perfectly fine. But how does it do that if we consider that neither the stator or rotor consist of permanent magnets, but all the other hobbyist motor types I talked about in previous basics videos always used some kind of magnets in order to create torque? Well, for that, let's imagine the stator looks like this. And we got one coil pair for each phase positioned inside the stator like this. If we look at the voltages across our coil pairs, we can see that we're dealing with three sine waves, which are positioned 120 degrees out of phase to one another. That means, since there are sine voltages applied to our coils, sine currents are also flowing. Of course, when there's a current, there's also a magnetic field, which, according to the different amplitudes of the current through each phase, creates a changing magnetic field, which, if we look at it for quite some time, spins around and thus is called a rotating magnetic field. Now this rotating magnetic field induces a voltage into the metal sticks of the rotor. And since they're all shorted, there's a current flowing, which once again creates a magnetic field that this time opposes the original rotating field of the stator and thus creates a force which basically pushes the rotor away and lets it spin. And now that we know the functional basics, we should be able to assume that because we are working with a 50 Hz voltage, our rotor should follow this stator frequency with an RPM of 3000. So I used my tachometer in order to measure an RPM of just below 3000 RPM. But why is it a bit lower? Well, let's imagine the rotor and stator would spin with the exact same frequency. The problem is that in this case, according to the induction law, no voltage would be induced into the rotor, and thus no current would flow and no opposing forces would be created, which means no rotating. So it is pretty logical that the rotor must turn a bit slower than the stator frequency, which is also why this motor type is called asynchronous. This difference in RPM is actually called slip, and it is an important characteristic of such motor types. As a comparison, a common BLDC motor is actually a synchronous motor type, because if we look at the frequency of the applied three-phase AC voltage, then we can do some calculations and find out that the rotor is spinning with this exact RPM. The reason for that is, like I already mentioned, the permanent magnets of this motor type. Now to alter the RPM of our asynchronous motor, we can either get a pretty expensive electronic frequency converter, or we get an asynchronous motor with more poles, like this one with 4 instead of just 2. That means we got 2 pole pairs, and thus the rotation of the magnetic fields should take twice as long. And this equation also confirms that the RPM should get cut in half, which, as you can see, it did. Now at this point, you might wonder why asynchronous motor appliances, like this water pump, only uses one phase and the neutral wire instead of 3-phase AC voltage. The solution can be found when we open up its terminal box, which looks a bit confusing at first, but the main difference of this box is the utilized capacitor. The reason is that this motor still needs to create a rotating magnetic field, which it does so by utilizing the L and N phase, and additionally a capacitor, which creates a third phase with a phase shift of 90 degrees. This way, the rotating field is more like an ellipse than a circle, but this method works just fine for smaller asynchronous motors. And with that being said, we are now familiar with all the basics, and thus I was confident in hooking up my old motor through a star configuration to the grid. And as you can see, it works perfectly fine. Awesome! The reason why this motor type is so popular is because it is simple to make, robust and relatively cheap. And most importantly, it is easy to use. You just have to hook it up to the power grid and you're done. You don't need DC voltage or stepper driver IC or an ESC in order to drive it, which can all be potential causes of defects. And if you want to learn even more about asynchronous motors, then I would highly recommend checking out the links in the video description, because there's a lot more to learn. As always, thanks for watching. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!